In this video, I will introduce to you the concept of principal component analysis, or for short, PCA. Principal component analysis, or PCA, is concerned with explaining the variance-covariance structure of a set of variables through a few linear combinations of these variables. This means that PCA will work on multivariate data to use linear combination of variables to capture the variability of the original data set. What PCA aims to do mostly is to reduce dimension of the data without losing much information. This information we are talking about is the variability of the data. Some textbooks might also call this data reduction. However, be careful that this does not mean that less data is collected. I'll show you this in the next slide. Another minor objective of PCA is to interpret the data, but this is less so because PCA is usually a technique that is an intermediate step towards further analysis like multiple linear regression, factor analysis, discriminant analysis, and even machine learning. Let me now explain these objectives with some illustrations. So recall that PCA will work on multivariate data to capture the variability of the data set by using some linear combination of the variables. And it aims to reduce dimension but not losing much information, meaning capture as much variability of the data as possible. So let's take for example, we want to investigate the price of necessary goods like bread and rice. So we sampled 100 shops and recorded the prices of 2 brands of bread and 3 brands of rice. In this case, we have 100 observations and 5 variables. Let's call these variables x1, x2, x3, x4, and x5. So x1 is the price of a bread that is brand P, all the way to x5 is the price of rice, which is brand C. Now suppose we transform this data to find the average price of bread and rice. Let's call them y1 and y2. So y1 is the average price of the bread, which means to find y1, I will take the price of bread brand P and the price of bread brand Q and average them. So that will be half of x1 plus half of x2. As for y2, y2 is the average price of rice. So I'm taking the rice brand A, rice brand B, and rice brand C and average them out. So y2 is essentially 1/3 of x3 plus 1/3 of x4 plus 1/3 of x5. As you can see, we have originally 5 variables and now we have 2 variables. So we have reduced the number of data, or rather we have reduced the number of dimensions from 5 to 2. However, remember that even when we collect data, we still need to collect 5 data points for each set of measurement. It doesn't mean that you collect less data, but the dimensions has been reduced from 5 to 2. Now, if this transformation is done according to PCA criteria, I will call each of Y1 and Y2 a principal component. However, in this example, I am not certain that by reducing the dimension, I have retained the variability. That is, I cannot guarantee that there is no loss of information. Will I be able to recreate this data if I have this data? I don't think so. So by transforming, I have lost information. So how does PCA transform data such that variability is captured as much as possible? So generally, although P components are required to reproduce the total system variability, which in this case, I need 5 components, which means 5 variables, is required to capture the variability of the whole data set. Often, much of this variability can be accounted by a small number m of the principal components. In this case, I'm saying that maybe m can be just 2. I reduce dimension of 5 to dimension of only 2. If this is done, then we have as much information in these two dimensions or these two variables as in the original 5 variables. So if there is no loss of information, these two variables or principal components can then replace the initial p variables, which in this case is 5 variables, which is the original data set of 100 or in general n measurements on these 5 variables. So let me now show you how PCA can do this transformation yet capture as much information as possible. Now, in order to capture as much variability as we can, we need to find the axis of maximum variability. Let's take this bivariate data as an illustration. Now, recall that we use eigenvalue and eigenvector analysis to find the axis of maximum variability, which in this case is along this direction. So subsequently, the second axis will be orthogonal, or simply speaking, perpendicular to the first axis in order to capture the variability that cannot be captured by the first axis. So this direction, which is the axis of the maximum variability, is called PC1. And this second axis, which is perpendicular to the first axis, is called PC2. Then PCA will then find linear combination of the variables by rotating the data distribution such that the axis of this maximum variance, which is PC1, becomes the new horizontal axis. This rotation is called Varimax rotation. The second axis, which is PC2, will then be the new vertical axis. Now, to illustrate further, I have 3 sets of bivariate data here. In data set A, the axis of maximum variability, or PC1, seems to be in this direction, and hence the second axis, or PC2, is in this direction. In data set B, PC1 seems to be in this direction, hence PC2 is in this direction. In data set C, PC1 seems to be in this direction, hence PC2 is in this direction. Now notice that PC2 in data set C does not capture much variability as opposed to data set A. We say there is high redundancy in data set C and low redundancy in data set A. So in data set C, we will likely drop PC2 and retain only PC1. In this way, we manage to reduce the dimension from 2 to only 1, yet retain as much variability as possible. Hence, in a nutshell, dimension reduction will be very successful if there is high redundancy in the data set. Now, as with every technique, there are assumptions and limitations that we should be aware of. Firstly, sample size. As PCA works with multivariate data, we need to make sure that sample size is large enough. Secondly, normality. PCA is actually a non-parametric analysis, so normally distribution is not necessary. However, if the variables are truly normally distributed, then the solution will be enhanced. Thirdly, linearity. Since we are taking linear combinations, please note that linearity is assumed. Fourthly, orthogonality. So usually, after we find PC1, which is the axis of maximal variability, PC2 will then be perpendicular to PC1. And then if there's a PC3, it should also be perpendicular to both PC1 and PC2. And if there is a PC4, then it should be perpendicular to PC1, PC2, and PC3.